I'm going to go ahead and call this meeting to order of the Falls Church City Council, this regular meeting of Monday, March 24th. And if we can, let's rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you. Madam Clerk, will you call the roll call, please?
Mr. Baruch?
Here.
Ms. Connolly?
Here.
Mr. Duncan?
Here.
Ms. Oliver?
Here.
Mr. Snyder?
Here.
Mr. Z?
Here.
Mayor Tarter?
Here.
Thank you, Council.
Do we have a motion to adopt a meeting agenda?
Move we adopt the meeting agenda.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries. We do have a proclamation, I believe, today. Let's see. Ms. Messner?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Before you this evening is a proclamation that would declare April 1 through 7 as Local Government Education Week. Would be the second year we've asked Council to enact this. This is based on a General Assembly action in 2012 that followed from the advocacy work of the Local Government Managers Association, and it's a way to work with young students to learn more about government as a career and succession planning. And last year I had the opportunity to go to two of our schools and read a elementary school book that we're encouraging all divisions in the state to do on City Hall, out and about, all the services and what a city manager does, council, city clerk. And so I've talked to the school superintendent about us participating in that again this year. And so statewide, this is an initiative, and we respectfully request council to consider it as well.
Thank you very much. I'm going to go ahead and read the proclamation now. Whereas since the colonial period, the Commonwealth of Virginia has closely held the institutions of local government, and whereas local governments throughout the Commonwealth provide valuable services to the citizens and communities they served, and whereas citizen services such as law enforcement, public health and safety, recreational opportunities, and educating local children are most often delivered at the local level, and whereas in recognition of the work performed by local governments, the Virginia General Assembly on February 29th, 2012, designated the first week in April as Local Government Education Week in Virginia, and whereas April 2nd, 1908 was the creation of the council manager form of government in the city of Staunton, thereby making the first week in April appropriate for this designation. Now, therefore, I, P. David Tarter, mayor of the City of Falls Church, do hereby proclaim the week of April 1st through the 7th, 2014 as Local Government Education Week in the City of Falls Church, and further proclaim that the Falls Church City Government, Falls Church Public Schools, will partner to promote civic education and engagement in an effort to educate citizens about their local government, strengthen the sense of community, and engage the next generation of local government managers. In witness thereof, I hereby set my hand and cause the seal of the City of Falls Church to be affixed this 24th day of March, 2014. Thank you, Ms. Messner. Would you like to... Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Messner. I understand we also have an oath of office to administer. Is that correct? Would you please approach? Welcome. I tell you what, I think you probably go over there. Congratulations, and thank you for your service. When you're done, why don't you come on up and you can meet the members of City Council. Okay, let's move on to public comment. I do have two speakers listed. I don't know if there are anyone else who wishes to speak tonight, but if you do wish to speak, please bring your speaker slip to the clerk. We'd ask that you give your name and your address, and you limit your comments to 3 minutes. Thanks so much. Let's start with Kathy Chandler, please. Welcome. Thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you for having me. My name is Kathy Chandler. I live at 312 North Underwood Street in Falls Church. And I'm here tonight as chair of the Rec and Park Advisory Board. We owe the City Council once a year an open space report, and it's been snowed out, and conflicts have kept us from coming earlier. So I'm here tonight to present our open space report. In 2004, the council actually convened an open space committee, and they worked for 2 years and wrote a very elaborate report and made a number of recommendations about what the city should do in terms of open space. That committee then stopped working, and it fell to the Rec and Park Advisory Board to sort of keep tabs on what we should be doing in terms of open space. So that's how it fell to our board roughly 8-10 years ago. I'll leave a copy of the report. I think maybe you got it at a work session, because we thought we'd be talking to you at a work session, but I'll leave it for you tonight. Open space clearly is very important to our city. As our school population grows and our overall population grows, there's not only stress on the schools, but stress on things like the rec and park services that we provide to our citizens. We've made a number of recommendations in our report, and I'll briefly go over them. We really feel that a portion of the water sale proceeds should go into an open space fund. We feel that's a good use of that money. We've had it started out as $2 million, but spent down now it's about $1.15 million set aside for bondable money to be available for purchases of open space or acquisition of open space as opportunities arise. This has been in the CIP. When the CIP sort of went down with the recession, we kind of didn't know what happened to that 1.15 that was still remaining, but I believe it's back in the CIP now this year, and we're very excited to see that. What that gives us is the opportunity to act more quickly when opportunities come up. Some of the opportunities that we really would like to pursue is expansion of some of our park space. Whenever we see land adjacent to our current parks, it's very important to look at that space and decide whether it would make a good addition to expand the park or offer another kind of opportunity around the park. Another way to spend open space money is through easements to get into parks. Some of our parks have very limited access routes into them, so we feel like we should pursue very vigorously this year looking for easements to allow other access into parks. We do feel that when the Pendleton House property sold, that money should have probably come back to the Open Space Committee also in terms of being able to fund some of these things. We would like the council to consider putting what we think of as $2 million in a easy access open space fund, with the idea that as things are purchased, then the next time we have COP comes around, boost it back up to $2 million. Having that much available, we feel is a good amount, and that was what was recommended 10 years ago in terms of having money available for open space. Another thing we think is very important is that as developers come and we start looking at what they're going to give back in terms of proffers, open space, rec and park are not there. So we want the City Council to consider making it possible for rec and park and open space to to be at the table as developers come start with their projects and trying to figure out how to add more of this open space in Rec and Park to what they would offer. And those are the main recommendations. The report actually has a very interesting quote, and it goes back to, it's a quote about the city's master plan, and I'll just read it. "We find that we have gone backward rather than forward in acquiring land for park purposes. At this time, there is so little underdeveloped land available that the city must take bold steps to acquire any at all, let alone what the city of this size and character should have." That quote came from 1964. So here we are 50 years later, and I think we can say the same thing. And that's how our report goes. I have one other piece of business, which was that the Park and Rec and Park Advisory Board actually did approve sending you a letter saying that we would very much like for the Rec and Park staff to be represented on the George Mason, Mary Ellen Henderson Joint Campus Planning Committee. We understand that you put together that committee without having membership from Rec and Park. But given the very close relationship between Rec and Park and the schools and our MOU on joint use of space and so forth, we think it's very important to have representation on that committee. So thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate your service. Our next speaker is Mr. Nick Benton. Welcome. Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Nick Benton, 400 James Court, owner editor of the Falls Church News Press. I have a couple things, not necessarily related. First is, this is Restaurant Week, and over 30 restaurants in the Falls Church and Median environs are participating in it, with specials, fixed-priced, three-course meals and so forth, lunch and dinner. Really some terrific opportunities to dine and become more familiar with the restaurants. I just have to say that Restaurant Week is the sole responsibility of one person, and that's the best managing editor in the world, Jody Fellows, who conceived of this idea, developed it, and is solely responsible for all the publicity that's gone out on it, working with the restaurants and everything else. So I hope you will partake of that. Secondly, I've got a couple things to say about the budget, if it's appropriate to do that now. I will. Because I think it's absolutely critical that the schools get the funds they need to continue to manage the explosive growth, and the fact that if the schools started to fall by the wayside, that would be the worst cataclysmic disaster to happen to the city because of the value added that those schools provide to our tax base and everything else here. I've been looking at other ways the city can obtain revenues or avoid costs than simply taxing the citizens with real estate taxes and this new tax, which is called a fee, the stormwater fee. And first on the stormwater fee, I just want to say that it came to my attention that there was an article just a year ago in the American City and County magazine that was called Underwater. And the subtitle was, "Because many communities cannot afford to comply with EPA water mandates, the agency is beginning to adjust compliance deadlines." Now, part of the rationale for the stormwater fee being passed tonight, which you're on your agenda to do, is the fact that if we didn't do it, we'd be sued by the EPA, according to the mandates that they've put out. Well, here's an article in a prestigious magazine of a year ago that says that the EPA is backing off of that. Now, why should we go ahead and pass this thing and put this new fee burden on our homeowners and residents in this city, including incredible burdens on institutions like our local churches, without exploring just how serious the EPA is or isn't about enforcing compliance. I mean, do we have time? Do we have a year, 2 years to get into compliance? What's the deal? We haven't heard anything about that. Seems to me that the thing to do is to table this motion tonight pending an investigation of that. Seems reasonable. Okay, that's whatever the total amount of the fees are. The fees, by the way, because they're called fees and not taxes, are not tax deductible, and there is no relief for people based on income difficulties, like taxes. The second way we could save a lot of money is on this issue of fund balance. And nothing personal, sir. Fund balance is simply an issue of how much money sits in the bank, taxpayer money sits in the bank doing nothing while we engage in the affairs of government. The fund balance is, right now, the city policy is 12 to 17%. We know that it's for a long time, in the last couple of years, been higher than that, more money in the bank than even our own policy. Well, let me just point out to you that when the fund balance policy was initiated by the City Council in Falls Church in the mid-1990s, the fund balance range was 8 to 12%. Okay? I don't know what point and the rationale for why it got shifted from 8 to 12% to 12 to 17%, but we're right at the top now, 17% of annual expenditures. Now, if annual expenditures, according to this budget, are about $80 million, 1% is $800,000. So if we took down all the way from 17 to 8, the amount you need to keep in the bank at any one time, you would be saving, I don't know what the math is, but 800,000 times 12, okay? Do the math and then divide by cents on the tax rate, and I think we come out being able to save taxpayers, just by doing that, 27 cents on the tax rate, okay? That's a lot of money that's just not being used now. And, you know, you could do some part of that, not necessarily the whole thing. The second is to basically say, another way to save some money, just take, like Kathy proposed, $2 million out of the windfall money from the water sale and put it to a special use. Well, just take a million, take 1.2 million, that's 3 cents on the tax rate right there. Just one time deal, because we're waiting to get some of our new projects up and running, they're gonna bring a lot of revenue. But for now, the burden on taxpayers is so severe that we have people in town, and I've heard it too, more strident in their opposition to funding the schools, people who normally for the schools, just because they're so overwhelmed by everything that's going on, with the real estate values going way up. Now you want to put 4.5 cents on top of that. Now you want to put a stormwater fee on top of that. Well, I've just given you three ways to take that burden away from the taxpayer and keep the schools funded the way they need to be and run the operations of government. So please take that under advisement, and I thank you.
Thank you for your comments. We appreciate them. Our last speaker is Mr. Hal Morgan. Mr. Morgan, welcome. Thank you.
Mayor Tarter, members of council, my name is Hal Morgan. I live at 907 Hillwood Avenue, and I'm here this evening to represent the Citizens Advisory Committee on Transportation and present our annual report to you. The report and its appendices are in your meeting packet, and I would like to spend the time allotted to me highlighting our key CACT accomplishments last year, telling you what we hope to accomplish in 2014, and providing you with our funding recommendations. Last year, our work efforts included improvements to the WNOD trail, including the removal of invasive plants, developing a project to install bicycle wayfaring and sharrows to connect up WNOD trail users to the city's commercial areas, hosting the city's Bike to Work Day pit stop, acting on petitions for neighborhood traffic calming, developing the Mobility for All Modes transportation chapter of the comprehensive plan, and reviewing and providing transportation input on city projects. For 2014, the CACT has identified three key elements for our work action efforts. First is complete the Mobility for All Modes transportation chapter of the Comprehensive Plan. Second, work with staff to initiate the implementation of the Mobility for All Modes transportation chapter of the Comprehensive Plan, beginning with working with staff to reassess the neighborhood traffic calming program to ensure the program responds to the areas of greatest need first and includes sufficient funding and staff support, and seeking city funding, civic funding, and volunteer support for the construction and maintenance of plazas along the WOD trail. And thirdly, to continue to provide the core service expected of the Citizens Advisory Committee on Transportation by accepting petitions for the city's neighborhood traffic calming program and applying a transportation perspective to city plan project reviews, such as the Kensington project. Now, for the funding. For the neighborhood traffic calming program to fulfill its purpose of protecting pedestrians, cyclists, transit users, and motorists, and supporting improved quality of life on city residential streets, the program needs dedicated funding. The CACT recommends that council establish a recurring CIP item of $400,000 per year for construction and essential additional staff support for traffic calming on residential streets. And to fulfill the potential of the WNOD trail as a travel and recreation corridor, a reflection of the city's unique identity and a gateway to city commercial areas, investment is needed in trailside amenities. The CAT recommends that the council restore funding in the amount of $200,000 in the 2015 to 2019 CIP for five plazas along the WNOD trail. The requested $200,000 will be used to cover staff, design, and installation costs. And once construction, we recommend budgeting $5,000 a year for plaza maintenance. We appreciate the opportunity to serve our city by improving the safety and effectiveness of the transportation network, and we look ahead to assisting you in innovatively addressing the challenges of a growing population and an increasing travel volume. And I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have any on our report.
Thank you, Mr. Morgan. We really appreciate your service to the city. Mr. Z, it sounds like you have a question.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you, Vice Chair Morgan. I'm really glad to see that we are amplifying our efforts in this particular area of endeavor. Thank you for all the good work that you do. We have added two energetic city staff members, Paul Stoddard and Kirsten Munns. And I noticed one of them, even as we speak, is here probably giving up family life and dinner. We've also endeavored to add new members to the committee, and one of them was just sworn in tonight. So I have nothing but optimism for where we're going to be taking this in the future. So my questions go to next steps. You have ambitious agenda here and lots of great ideas, but they don't seem to have any schedule or cost attached to them. I would like to figure out, maybe your committee could report back or through staff, how we get to the all-important critical pricing part. And I say that because we have the opportunities with upcoming proposed development in the city to actually figure out a way to fund the WNOD trail improvements, the kiosk operations, and perhaps something more than just a place for the bike rider to stop and get some shade, but could actually partake of nourishment and other kinds of things from small businesses in the city that have been given the opportunity to run a kiosk operation there. Moreover, I think that additional discussion needs to be had on what we do with reconfiguring the trail. As we get away from a historic rail bed into something else that works only for bicycles and walkers and runners, I think that we need to have a more complete discussion on how we change the trail. And finally, I would suggest with the signage on the Sheros, I would welcome your opinion on this, that in addition to painting little arrows and a bicycle symbol that perhaps as a low-cost way of slowing down traffic by some of these appliques from organizations like Drive As If Your Kids Lived Here, but I'm not just talking about yard signs here, I'm talking about a 10 by 15 applique on the road surface in red and white that should get someone's attention. I would welcome your opinions on that, if not tonight, maybe later.
Sure, I mean, I think the applique, I think that is a good thing. It's pretty interesting. I was reading, there's an article in Arlington Magazine this month about traffic and traffic calming and the traffic issues in Arlington. They tried to drive for 25 campaign to get the people to slow down in Patrick Henry, for example. And after a year of the campaign, they found that the speed limit actually went up on average 4 miles an hour. So, I mean, that's one of the problems in the whole area is to get people to slow down. And maybe an applique is the way to do it. I mean, I think, you know, in Falls Church, Paul was saying there's only two places, and I think one's on North Washington, one's on South Washington, where the speed limit is 30 miles an hour. Every place else, it's 25. So we just have to get people to slow down and be, and just, you know, and smell the roses, if you will. But and I'm willing to, you know, we're willing as a committee to discuss any ways with you to do that.
Other questions, comments? I guess I would have a question for staff is, clearly there's a lot of money at stake and cost to make these improvements. Is there any grant money, you know, federal or state grant money that we might apply for these kind of measures that you're aware of or that we could look into?
We just talked about the transportation CIP last Thursday, and that is almost entirely grant funded or state and federal funded, but maybe Cindy Mester could speak about its applicability to the types of things that the CACT have identified.
For the general neighborhood traffic calming program, we do have one CIP project that's labeled pedestrian accessibility, and it is using the RSTP grant funds as proposed by your transportation staff. And that is at a $300,000 a year amount, and then we have the two FTEs that partly would help administer that. Now, we are currently working with this funding source and also MVTA funding source to make sure that its uses are fully eligible in the residential, so we can't yet confirm if all of that could go towards those type of projects, but we are looking at that. Currently, there's not a general fund proposal that would match what the CACT is recommending. And for the WNOD trail piece, last year it was in the CIP, as noted in the CACT's report, but it was only if grant funding was located or found. It wasn't actually funded by pay-as-you-go or local debt, so I did want to clarify that. That could be something, as mentioned, that could be a proffer negotiation or some other grant type of source.
Thank you very much. Mr. Duncan?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. To follow on what Mr. Z said, all our boards and commissions work hard, but CACT, I think, works especially hard and is often at the front line of neighborhood concerns about traffic congestion, development, and so forth. The few times I've had a chance to stick my nose in and see your meetings, there is often a large crowd of citizens from some neighborhood or another there, so we appreciate the work that you do to, you know, absorb some of the concerns that we generate up here with the activities that we do. And in line with that, I'd just like to make sure that our record reflects that the Parker and Kent Street project, which went through your processes of review and justification and which we're voting on, I think, later tonight as part of a budget amendment for a traffic pedestrian safety and traffic calming project, which will begin to get underway fairly soon, is an example of how our process does work through your committee, and I hope that we will have more resources available to do more of those kind of things as they are warranted. It will make more work for you all, but we know you're up to it. Go ahead.
No, go ahead. So we'd appreciate it.
Okay. Just one specific question on the Sharrows, particularly the bicycle path that is being laid out from the city line, there on Little Falls up to downtown. It runs for a block up Little Falls, then takes a left on Columbia, and then back onto Maple. I had a question as to why that dog leg, and that's a sort of a local concern. The broader question is the signs that are put up to indicate these sharrows, will they be placed in a way as to minimize the visual impact on the neighborhood? And will the people who live along the streets where the sharrows will be painted and the signs will be put up get a heads up before that work is done so that, you know, they won't just wake up one morning and see something outside? Even if they like it, sometimes that can be a little alarming.
Well, to answer your questions in order, first, the first question is that when you come up Little Falls, we thought first about bringing people up Little Falls, but it's pretty steep, so we thought that get them to Maple. Then we had two choices, Jefferson or Columbia, and I believe it or not, it was the reasoning is that people said that Columbia, we're bringing people from, hopefully from outside, who are not in City of Falls Church, into City of Falls Church, and they said Columbia was a more beautiful block, better looking street, so they thought that would be, you know, a better way to portray the city. As far as your second question with the signage, I mean, that is definitely a concern. You don't want the signage to all of a sudden add to the blight of the street, which we're the streets we're trying to, you know, show off. So there are ways that the people who, when they chose the signs, they will station them in such a place that they'll blend in with the environment. There'll be a fence or a tree or something there that the sign will kind of blend in, and the person who, the people who live in the homes, probably won't even notice that they're there. And then the third question, yeah, certainly we'll have neighborhood meetings. We're going to let the neighborhoods know when they're going to, shows are going to come on. It's going to be in conjunction with the street paving, so this summer. So the paving will be done, and then the shows will go in. So they'll be, I think people will always pleased when their streets are repaved, and so it'll be, I think they'll be more amenable to the shows going in, I hope.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate it.
Thank you all.
Moving on, Madam Clerk, are there any written comments?
Yes, quite a few.
Summarize them for us, please.
Sure. Lisa Hartwick of 318 South Virginia Avenue asked Council to consider banning or placing stronger restrictions on the use of leaf blowers. Gary Hughes of Arlington said the Kensington needed to provide sufficient parking since many shift workers would not have public transportation available to them during the hours they would be commuting. He proposed that the facility charge its residents a monthly parking fee to discourage them from having cars, and noted that access for emergency vehicles was important for an assisted living facility, and asked that this, as well as additional elevators and emergency power for the building, be addressed prior to the approval of the project. Fred Foss of 119 East Jefferson Street complained about the lack of enforcement for construction vehicles on East Jefferson Street. Tim Stevens, chair of the Environmental Services Council, said the ESC supported the adoption of TO14-04 to bring the city's stormwater management practices into compliance with new state regulations. Glenn R. Bernard, representing the owners of 501 North Van Buren Street, wrote to express his client's opposition to the agreement of conditions of vacation submitted by the Hiscotts. There were several comments regarding the Broad and West project. Jennifer and Tom Bain of 310 Grove Avenue said they were generally supportive of redevelopment at the intersection, but were concerned about the proposed number of two-bedroom units and the likelihood of increased traffic, speeding, and overflow parking on Grove Avenue. They would not fully support the project unless these issues were addressed. Nancy Morrison, president of the Steeples Court Homeowners Association, was concerned about traffic and stormwater issues related to the proposed project. She said traffic already blocked the entrance of Steeples Court, and the association worried that would get worse. There was also an undersized stormwater pipe under West Street, which had already caused flooding that blocked traffic on West Street. Meredith Donnelly, 208 Grove Avenue, wrote to express concerns regarding the parking, traffic, and number of two-bedroom units in the proposed West and Broad project. She did not support the proposed retail space due to concerns that tenants would not be able to afford the rent. John Murphy of 308 Chestnut Street was concerned about the impact the proposed West and Broad project would have on the surrounding neighborhood. He said the project did not have enough parking and there should be a better plan for traffic management in the area surrounding the development. Lisa Veruxis of 301 Grove Avenue opposed the proposed West and Broad mixed-use development. She said the city needed a change to attract new businesses, but should retain its small-town feel. She objected to the loss of businesses currently located on the site, rezoning the land to allow for greater height, lack of parking, increased traffic, apartments with more than one bedroom, and the businesses being proposed for the development, including a drugstore and extended stay hotel. Ms. Veruxis has said she favored a scaled-down mixed-use development with four stories of efficiency and one-bedroom apartments over one level of retail and restaurant space, including retail space with a reduced rate for local businesses that are currently located in the area. Mark Gross, Vice President of the Falls Church Village Preservation and Improvement Society, said that VPIS was supportive of commercial development compatible with the community character along the city's main arteries and had concerns about the proposed West and Broad development, including lack of focused development, traffic issues, insufficient parking, loss of a historic house on West Broad Street, and encroachment into a residential neighborhood. Lorraine O'Rourke of 807 Link Avenue opposed the proposed development at West and Broad because of the impact it would have on traffic, the loss of current businesses on the site, and the increased number of residents and school children the apartments would add to the city. Miriam Ward, 302 Grove Avenue, said she was looking forward to the redevelopment of the West and Broad area and hoped there would be a place for the new building for the businesses that are currently in that location. She was concerned about the parking and traffic generated by the building and urged the council not to compromise on the number of parking spaces or improvement to the flow of traffic in the area. Regarding the budget, Neil Hopper asked how the city could propose an increase in the tax rate at a time when assessments have risen and will continue to do so, in addition to the stormwater fee. He stressed how burdensome city taxes are and asked that the council rein in the tax rate and consider the social and fiscal ramifications of such a cavalier taxing attitude. Kathy Rice of 1110 Jackson Court urged the council to consider contracting out more city services. She said the cost to live in the city would increase even if the tax rate stayed the same due to increased assessments and the new stormwater fee. Contracting with larger municipalities or private companies could lower some of the city's operating costs. Dave Mercer of 207 Grove Avenue asserted that the stormwater fee was an additional tax on residents that, in addition to increased assessments, would cause his proposed taxes to increase 12% in 2014. He said that school class size was not related to quality of education and the school board should cut the budget and staff and pay the remaining teachers competitively. Lisa Veruxis of 301 Grove Avenue urged the council and school board to remove any line items in the budget that were not critical to the health and well-being of the city and to utilize the revenues received by increased assessments to fund a slimmed down budget. She also said the proposed development should not be allowed to include apartments with two or more bedrooms in order to prevent overcrowding in the school system. Jesse Roth, president of the George Mason High School Athletic Booster Association, requested that the funding for the replacement of the GMHS sports field be included in the FY 2015 budget rather than put off until FY 2018. Jurgen Torin of 117 Gresham Place said he appreciated the school board chair's clear explanation of the school's proposed budget, but felt that great schools were not the only reason people moved to the city and citizens were not getting value for their money. Mr. Torin suggested that it may become too expensive for the city to maintain its own school system, given the projected pupil growth rate. And Dennis Tolliver of 525 Timber Lane opposed increased taxes as well as the new stormwater fee. He felt the taxes should be decreased to make up for increased assessments, and the stormwater fee should be incorporated in proposed property taxes. He suggested that the schools move toward a fee-based system for certain student activities and advanced classes.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Oliver?
Sorry, I just wanted to make a comment at the end of the citizens' action.
Sure, of course.
Committee on Transportation, and I really just wanted to thank Mr. Morgan for coming forward. I'm really sorry that the committee was not able to meet the previous month because of the snowstorm, and therefore they couldn't bring this report to us a month sooner. We're under tremendous budget pressure, and you've highlighted some unmet needs, and I think it's just important for people to realize that those unmet needs exist. And I wanted to thank you for coming forward and making sure that we were aware of that. And also, Andrea, for sticking around to help deliver that report as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any council requests? Okay, yes, Mr. Snyder.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Last Friday, I had the opportunity to represent the city at a meeting with the Virginia Attorney General, where he wanted various jurisdictions to talk about their priorities. And I'm gonna get to the request in a minute. I laid out four principal issues from my experience that are important in law enforcement in our community. The first is continued strong regional cooperation with increased funding to address gang activity. Second, to make sure that we are using all the authority that we have, and it's very restricted, to keep firepower out of the hands of people that shouldn't have it. Third, that when the legislature passed a law preventing cities from annexing, they made certain commitments about funding public safety that were never carried out. And finally, and this connects directly with what CACT just said, that the state give us more tools, including the use of speed enforcement cameras, to better control speeding and other traffic safety issues in our jurisdiction. And that issue in particular was seconded by Fairfax County Board of Supervisors, our representative there. So what I would ask is, if council's in agreement, ask that the city manager prepare a letter for my signature to follow up with the Virginia Attorney General on those issues, and confirm with Chief Gavin, who attended a session in Arlington County on similar issues. If that would be agreeable, then I would ask the city manager to prepare a letter for my signature.
It sounds like that would be agreeable to everyone. Sure, thank you, Mr. Vice Mayor, for your assistance. Let's move on then to the report of the city manager, please. Mr. Shields.
Mayor Tarter, members of council, given the full agenda tonight, I would defer my report tonight and provide that to the council in writing.
TO14-04 is an ordinance to create Chapter 35 Stormwater Article 1 Stormwater Management of the Falls Church City Code and to modify Chapter 48 zoning to remove stormwater development criteria and create a cap on impervious coverage.
This ordinance is coming to the City Council on second reading. It's been discussed at length by the council in prior meetings, so I won't provide a long staff report. I would just note that this does not have any bearing on the stormwater utility or the stormwater fee. This is the regulatory requirements that the General Assembly has mandated that local governments adopt to create a higher regulatory regime to protect the Chesapeake Bay. And we do have a mandate to adopt this ordinance so that it goes into effect by July 1st. The one of the key things that we did discuss was the 35% hard cap, which would be taken out of the stormwater regulations, and we do have an amendment that adds it into the zoning ordinance. The City Council reviewed that, discussed that at first reading. It was referred to the Planning Commission. The Planning Commission supports that language, that amendment to the zoning ordinance, to keep that 35% hard cap in the zoning ordinance. They recommend that be kept basically as you saw it at first reading. The trigger for enforcement of that zoning regulation, the 35% hard cap, would be the trigger for the rest of the ordinance for enforcement, which is disturbance of at least 2,500 square feet of soil because of a major project in the residential neighborhoods, i.e. a tear down, rebuild, or a major addition. I'd be happy to answer any other questions on this ordinance, but that's just a quick update on it since the council last saw this on first reading.
Thank you very much. Questions for Mr. Shields?
Shields,
yeah, Mr. Baruch?
Mr. Shields, do you want to talk about the grandfathering provision?
What this does is it goes with the state language on grandfathering, and so it states that any projects with land disturbing activity, this is at line 183 in the staff report, any land disturbing activity for which a currently valid proffered or conditional zoning plan, preliminary or final subdivision plat, etc., or any document determined by the locality as being the equivalent of those approved by the City Council before July 1st, 2014, are grandfathered under the existing stormwater standards. And so that's the state standard for grandfathering. The council does have the option to move the July 1st, 2014 grandfathering date to an earlier date under the city's current authority to implement tougher stormwater standards. But that really would be, you know, any date between now and July 1st.
So the key thing there that I'm getting to is we're actually putting it to the last date possible under the grandfathering.
We're following the state model for it. That's right.
And we couldn't go beyond that.
That's correct.
Other questions? I've got one. Mr. Benton raised a few issues earlier this evening. Do you have any response to his comments?
Some of Mr. Benton's comments were geared towards the stormwater utility, and that's not really what this ordinance is about. This is a different state mandate.
But it was in regards to implementation of the...
But in terms of implementation, the EPA has established the total maximum daily load requirements, and that's driving our capital planning for stormwater treatment. And that has not been delayed. There has been discussion about pushing them to delay it, but it has not been delayed. The General Assembly, when they were considering the implementation of this mandate that applies directly to this ordinance, they discussed deferring it for a year, and they decided not to do that. And so the date remains a July 1st deadline for the localities to adopt this ordinance. One thing that they did do, however, is that smaller rural jurisdictions who do not fall under the MS4 permit are allowed to opt out of this regulatory regime. We're not one of those jurisdictions. We are mandated to have an MS4 permit, and so that opt-out provision does not apply to the City of Falls Church.
Thank you. Why don't we go ahead and open, let's start with a motion. Question.
If we're gonna have a bit of discussion about sort of the issue of the fees, which are sort of tied to this, isn't it also fair to say that part of the utility fee covers these new requirements, but part of it is dealing with current infrastructure and managing stormwater as we have it?
In terms of the fee structure itself or the stormwater utility?
The utility. So the utility would help fund the requirements that are mandated now, but also help with infrastructure that has generally nothing to do with water quality, which is being regulated, but more of how we're handling flooding in the city.
Well, they are slightly different. What this regulation applies to is property owners.
No, I understand that. I'm moving on to the...
But let me start here, and then I'll get to where you're trying to get to. This applies for property owners who are redeveloping their properties and the requirements that they have to fall under. It's relevant to the city's requirement, the mandate that the city will have to reduce its total maximum daily load of pollutants going downstream or leaving the city, because as people comply with this ordinance, that will allow us over the next 30 years to meet some of our pollution targets in a dispersed way, as opposed to, you know, strictly through the pocketbook of building public infrastructure to take care of the pollution that's being generated throughout the city, just, you know, from private property, parking lots, et cetera. And so that there is that connection, but there are two different regulatory regimes. One is on the municipality in terms of what our mandate is in terms of water leaving the city. This is a regulatory regime on private property owners. And they do mesh together, but.
I guess my question was slightly different. I mean, I think Mr. Benton's comment was part of the stormwater utility fees are being geared towards meeting various mandates. My point is that there's another aspect of it, and that's to manage the current stormwater infrastructure that we have, putting aside the additional unfunded mandates that are being placed upon the city and its residents.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood your question. You're
absolutely
right.
Yeah, that's why I was like jumping in. But.
Okay. Yeah, there's really three purposes. Correct. One is to meet the federal mandates. Two is to mitigate flooding that is occurring on private property. And third is to take care of aging infrastructure throughout the city, which we have maintained to some extent, but we've not maintained nearly enough.
So that's very helpful, Mr. Shields. So my point to Mr. Benton and the public is if we put aside the mandates, which I don't necessarily subscribe to what Mr. Benton said earlier, but even if you focus in on the other two, which is current infrastructure and flooding that's happening in the city, those are critical items that I think that we need to address. I mean, citizens have been facing those for numbers of years. If we don't manage it, it's either going to show up in the tax rate, which is one option we thought about and contemplated, but that would be based on valuation, which has nothing to do with how people are utilizing their property and what they're doing to mitigate any of that, or how much they're contributing to the issues that we're trying to remedy. And I think citizens have been dealing with this for a long time as far as flooding. The solutions or the impacts with the stormwater fee aren't going to take immediate effect. It's going to be a long-term process before we see improvements throughout the city, but they will happen project by project. And I think this is a core thing that the city does. Cities should be managing stormwater that's in our right-of-ways. And if we don't, it's something that we should be doing, and I think the utility gets us there in a way that's sustainable. That's understandably a difficult thing to do, but it's either put it off and deal with the flooding, where I think we've heard from citizens that that's a big issue, or we have to figure out a way of paying for it. And I think as the group went through, there was two ways, and ultimately the council and the advisory group thought that the most equitable way of handling it was through utility, where folks are paying based on the amount of coverage, and there's ways of mitigating that, and there's incentives for that people can utilize to lower their fees, and that was viewed as being the fairest way to handle it.
Thank you. Are there any other, Mr. Z?
Thank you. Since Mr. Rick brought up the topic here of fees, I just wonder if, as we talk about the new stormwater levy during the next 5 or 6 weeks, there are a good many questions about it still out in the community. And I wonder where we send people who ask us where their particular flooding problem is on the city's priority list. In other words, there's a document, a plan, and I think it'd be helpful for us to be able to point to that so that they can see, oh, well, I'm going to be dealt with next year or year three or whatever year it is, so that there's no mystery.
The plan that we have with the prioritized projects is in the stormwater management plan that was adopted about 3 years ago. And that can be found on the city's webpage. If you go to the city webpage, click on government, then click on Public Works. On that Public Works page is where the stormwater information is contained. If anyone has specific questions, they can email me, and we'll get them routed to the correct department to have their answers, to have their questions answered.
Thank you, Mr. Z.
I'd like to move this ordinance.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, my apologies. Let's have a motion then. Would you like, that would be a good way to move this along.
Mr. Z has to comment on this.
What's that? No, I thought he had a comment. I'm sorry. I saw you nodding and I thought he had a comment. All righty, let's go. Let's go have a motion. We have a motion?
I move council to adopt TO 14-04, an ordinance to create Chapter 35 Stormwater, Article 1 Stormwater Management of the Falls Church City Code, and to modify Chapter 48 Zoning to remove stormwater development criteria and create a cap on impervious coverage.
We have a second.
I'll second that.
Okay. We'll open this matter to the public. Is there anyone in the public who would wish to address this item? Now the matter is closed to the public. Any council comments? Mr. Z, now the comment.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to address my comments in three areas: the history and basis, and finally implementation. I'm glad to see that we've come a long ways from the last decade, where we treated stormwater and its effect on individual properties as basically your problem. If your property floods, you take care of it. We now see it as a public good. I would like to see us take it one step beyond, that we are able to finally reach a point where we treat the stormwater as a resource, figure out a way to monetize it, and not just as a waste to be treated and released. Secondly, on the basis of this being a fee, we follow the logic path. This comes from an unfunded federal mandate with a reciprocating state implementation. It applies to all that own real estate. No one is exempt. And finally, with only minor exculpatory basis, everyone has to pay. In my mind, that goes beyond a fee, an after-tax fee. I hope to address that aspect in time. Finally, implementation. As one who is affected, as are all property owners, I applaud the city's efforts in creating a system. And for that, I'm glad that we have fiber optic in the city, because it takes a while to download all these documents. However, the survey missed the fact that we have rain barrels and a rain garden on the property. Maybe not, that's not obvious from 120 miles up, but I'm happy to work with the city in figuring out how to calculate credits. Now, I brought with me the credit calculation form. I don't know whether you all have seen this or not. It's line A through P. It's only slightly less daunting than the IRS 1040 Schedule A. It says here, if it's N equals M times $18 minus J. Line O is C times 0.05. And then finally, P is the greater of either lines N or O. Did I get that right? Anyway, I'm looking forward to see how long it takes to traverse this with the obtaining the credits for a rain barrel, rain barrels and a rain garden. And I'll report back to council as to how long it takes and how much explaining it does. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Z. Any other comments, or should we move to a roll call vote? Mr. Baruch?
I'd just like to say that I support this ordinance.
Okay,
thank you. And I think I share some of the thoughts that Mr. Z had, but maybe not all of them. But and again, I would just remind staff, if any documents related to this or any other matter are going to the federal government or federal courts, that my name shouldn't be associated with it.
Thank you.
Just Madam, one, may I?
Sorry. Please.
Just one. Since the deadline to submit this obtuse credit form is March 31st, perhaps we could just remind folks of that if you can plow your way through it, you have, you know, a few more days to do so. And I don't know where things stand. I assume if a citizen has difficulty, they can call, and you guys will try to walk them through it as best you can. You know, what I hear people who have been here a long time saying is that they have done things over the years. You know, they've planted certain trees, they've done water gardens, they've done a number of mitigation activities, and they feel like they're not able to capture that on this sheet of paper the way the form works. So, all I've told people when they ask me that is, you know, call the city and talk with them, and hopefully something can be worked out.
Thank you, Mr. Duncan. Madam Clerk, will you call the roll call, please?
Mr. Baruch?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
Yes.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you. Can we call the next item, please?
TO-14-01 is an ordinance to amend the budget of expenditures and revenues appropriating funds for the fiscal year 2014 General Fund, Water Revenue Fund, Stormwater Fund, Capital Improvement Project Fund, and Special Transportation Capital Improvement Project Fund.
Mr. LeCondre.
Happy Monday, Council. What you have before you is a budget amendment.
Our intent is to transfer money to various items in the budget. The first category is $108,900, the general fund money. It's $65,000 in federal and state grants for $5,000 for parks and rec, $60,000 for public safety. We have use of assigned fund balance of $43,900, and that's to pay various contractors and to shift money from the general fund to stormwater. We have a use of contingency of $25,000. That's to address temporary staffing for court coverage. We have two items that we request be taken out of debt service and used to fund traffic calming and to hire additional staff for developmental services. We have transfers from the general fund to the water fund. I'm sorry, to the stormwater fund. That's the follow-up to the repair project. There's a decrease in the water fund budget. Since the sale of the water fund, we are now terminating our lease. And to do that, we need to defund this particular item in the budget. We are transferring money between projects, $54,000 from the North Washington Streetscape project to LED signal head replacement project. That's made up of federal funds and $1,000 of local funds. And we have money that is being transferred from roadbed construction to traffic signal management. There are two items there for that. $12,000 is going to bus shelters. And again, the pedestrian access program. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you very much. Do we have any questions for Mr. LaCondra? Mr. Duncan?
Thank you. Just to make it clear to everyone, this is the document that we talked about at our last meeting, correct, that we excised a certain section out. So this reflects that excision, and the numbers, the charted numbers in the back, are now where you want them to be?
Yes.
Okay. I always live in fear when we do this from the dais that my mother-in-law will call me and tell me that the columns on page 300 don't add up, and so I'm putting that on you. If she calls, I'm sending her straight to you.
You may.
Okay. And further, the item that was pulled out at the last meeting, Michelle Condre has agreed that he will come to the Budget and Finance Committee meeting tomorrow night and give a further briefing information. It's not related to this document here, because it's now a separate item, but and Mr. Z says that he would be available to come to that meeting, so anybody who's curious about that can come and listen tomorrow night at the Budget Finance Committee meeting. We'll do that, I think, right off the bat. Thank you.
Comments? Questions? Okay, why don't we go ahead and have a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve TO 14-01.
Second.
Okay. Let's open this to the public. Are there any members of the public who wish to address this matter? Seeing none, this matter is closed to the public. Do we have any council comments? No? Why don't we go ahead and have a roll?
Mayor, just very quickly, there are a number of important public safety and transportation issues dealt with in this, and I think it merits our support. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Madam Clerk, will you go to a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Baruch?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
Yes.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you. Let's move to the next item, please.
TO-14-03 is an ordinance to approve a 10-month extension of the cable television franchise held by Coxcom LLC until January 31st, 2015, to allow the city and the franchisee to complete renewal discussions.
So the this item is before the council on second reading. The title is self-explanatory. It's a 10-month extension of our Cox franchise agreement. We'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Any questions? Okay. Do we have a motion?
I move to adopt TO-14-03.
Second.
Okay, are there any members of the public that wish to address this matter? Seeing none, the matter is closed to public comment. Any council member comments? No? Madam Clerk, will you call a roll call vote, please?
Mr. Baruch?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
Yes.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you. Moving on to our first reading item items, Mr. Shields, is there a way we can combine? Our first reading items. Is there a way we can combine some of these? They're very similar subject matter, either for consideration or discussion, to expedite the review of these different related matters.
I would recommend that the council consider and have a public hearing for all six of the budget items together. And they all will need to be acted on separately by the city council for first reading and referral out to the public. But if they're all, if you can gather the council comments on them together, staff report together, and the public comment on them together, that would be the most efficient way to get through them.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, will you call those items then, please?
TO-14-19 is an ordinance fixing and determining the budget of expenditures and revenues appropriating funds for the fiscal year 2015. General fund, school operating fund, school community service fund, and school food service fund, sewer fund, stormwater fund, and affordable housing fund. TO-14-20 is an ordinance fixing and determining the FY 2015 to FY 2019 capital improvements program and appropriating expenditure and revenue funds for the fiscal year 2015. TO-14-05 is an ordinance to amend Chapter 40, Taxation, Article 7, Tax Relief for Low-Income, Elderly, or Permanently and Totally Disabled, Sections 40-133 through 40-137. TO-14-17 is an ordinance setting the rate of tax levy on real estate, personal property, machinery and tools, and all other property segregated by law for local taxation in the City of Falls Church, Virginia, for tax year 2014 and short tax year 2015. TO-14-21 is an ordinance to amend and revise Chapter 15 Fees, Article 2, Department of Development Services, to include updates to fees and language. And TO-14-22 is an ordinance to amend Chapter 42 Utilities to revise sewer rates and fees as of July 1st, 2014.
Thank you. Before we get started, I'd like to read a disclosure, if I may, with regard to City Council's consideration of the city's budget and the budget for the City of Falls Church Public Schools. I would like to disclose that my wife is employed by the city's public schools. My wife is a member of a group of three or more persons, the members of which are affected by the city and the school's budgets. I certify that I am able to participate in this matter fairly, objectively, and in the public interest. Thank you. Ms. Connolly?
I'd also like to disclose that I am employed by Falls Church City Public Schools, and this discussion pertains to my employer, part of the budget discussion will. However, I am a member of a group of three or more individuals affected by this matter. I certify that I can participate in the discussion fairly, objectively, and in the public interest.
Thank you. Mr. Shields, the staff report, please.
Okay, thank you, Mayor Tarter, members of council. I will just have a very brief report on each of these items, not a lengthy one. The council is spending almost all of your time with work sessions or other public meetings on these items, and so you either have or with additional work sessions, we'll have all the information with respect to each of these items. But just in terms of the overview for the budget ordinance, the first one that's listed here, as the council will recall, it does fund all of our operating expenditures as well as our different utility funds and the school operations and the school funds. In terms of the operating budgets, we do have a 3.6% increase in general government expenditures and a school board request for a 9.8% increase in the school transfer. This budget also funds the Stormwater Fund, which includes the fee that we've discussed earlier tonight, which was approved last spring, and that's incorporated in this budget ordinance as well. This is the first public hearing tonight on these items. We will have a second public hearing on April 14th, and then adoption for each of these items is scheduled for April 28th. We'll also have a Saturday town hall meeting here in council chambers on Saturday, April 5th at 10 a.m. The next item is the ordinance determining the capital improvements program. The council had a briefing on that on Thursday this past week. It has appropriations for our capital projects for schools, general government, and our utility funds. We'd be happy to answer any questions about that. What's important to understand about the CIP ordinance is that it does stand for an actual appropriation for the 2015 projects. For the projects that are in all the out years, the 4 years after 2015, it is simply a plan. It is not an appropriation. And those plans can change with subsequent updates to the CIP. The ordinance to amend the tax rates, for real estate and property are included in this ordinance. But before we get to that one, actually, we have the senior tax relief ordinance. And we are proposing a change to city code to expand the eligibility for senior tax relief and to increase the benefit for senior tax relief as well. This has been discussed in work session. We'd be happy to answer any questions on it. The tax rate ordinance for property taxes and real estate, what is in this ordinance for first reading is a real estate tax rate of $1.35 per each $100 of assessed value. That's a change of 4.5 cents from the current rate. The personal property, machinery, and tools tax rate of $4.84 is unchanged in this ordinance from the current rate. If the council adopts this on first reading, the tax rate can be lowered between first reading and second reading, but it cannot be increased. The ordinance to amend Chapter 15, our development fees, this was discussed by Department Director Jim Snyder. These are fees that are imposed on building permits in the city, and we're proposing to increase the fees essentially by 10% across the board as the base fee, and then have an additional 10% charge on fees that is computed after all the fees are tallied up for a building permit that would pay for technology upgrades to allow us to administer building permits more efficiently and more quickly. This would raise our fees to cover about 79% of our costs to conduct all of these public safety inspections. That rate, which is referenced in the staff report, of covering 79% of cost, I think is a high water mark, particularly this year, because we have had, with the Harris Teeter project, the reserve at Tenor Hill in particular, an unusually large number of fees. But with these fee increases, we believe we'll be able to sustain roughly about that coverage level of our costs. And I would also just note in the staff report that with these increases, if they're enacted, we would come to an effective rate of 60 cents per square foot of building, of new building in the city, is what the fee would be. And that compares to 90 cents per square foot for building permits in Arlington, our neighbor to the east. Fairfax County has a very different rate structure, so it's harder to do a per square foot comparison. We could do that for the council if you request it, but we do provide that comparison with Arlington County. And then lastly, with respect to our, the ordinance to amend Chapter 42, utilities to revise our sewer rates and fees. 3 years ago, we conducted a sewer rate study that was prompted by, the EPA mandates for cleaning up the Chesapeake Bay. And we have, with our partners with Arlington County and with Alexandria, taken on obligations that for plant upgrades that require a 9% increase in our sewer fees. This is the last year of those increases. We believe we need to update our sewer rate study over the coming year, but this is in accordance with the plan that was adopted 3 years ago. So that's a quick overview of the six items that are before the council relating to the budget, and again, we'd be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions for Mr. Shields? Any of these items? Mr. Baruch?
I have a question regarding on some of the CIP items. I know some of the CIP items are being financed through sale of property, and I think that we're going to get to that item shortly. I think it would be helpful if there was notes, and it may be actually in our bigger book, just outlining where the money's coming from. So if it's coming from sale of property, I'm specifically referring to the post office and EDC properties, that they somehow be highlighted just so we know that the money is coming from that particular source. No money is fungible, but it would be helpful for transparency to know that it's not just going into some fund in the, you know, like the general fund, that it's actually being utilized in the upcoming years. And the one thing I would note, for example, and this, I'm not sure if it's in, what the thought was, for example, I know one of the projects would be the transportation improvements in Big Chimneys, and I think that's showing up as debt financed in 17. Unclear if we're utilizing cash from the proceeds, which was previously discussed, why that wouldn't be as PAYGO. So if we can kind of look at those PAYGO versus cash for the figures that are being used from sale of proceeds, and I know there's sidewalk improvements and other transportation improvements that are being utilized throughout the city for proceeds from the sale of the potential sale from properties. So if we can just make sure that what we're saying is coming out of PAYGO and debt finance is right, because it strikes me as that doesn't quite square from what I know that we're utilizing cash on hand for once the sale goes through. And if we can kind of highlight those and show where the money flow is, just so people know that those proceeds are not just sitting in fund balance, that they're actually being utilized. And then also, if we can take a look on the outer years, why it's showing up as debt finance when it should be actually cash that we have set aside for the project. And on that note, if we are going to be doing things on out years, if there's a way of identifying it in the CIP, that will help us trace it back so we're not wondering what happened to the money. Similar to what happened with questions that have been raised about the open space fund.
Sure.
So I'd just rather not relive, trying to regroup what happened to money that would have gone in and out of the open space fund for some of the projects that we plan on doing. Thank you.
Mr. Schneider.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First a question and then a couple comments. And this is probably a question for the finance director. Why are we maintaining a fund balance at 17%? Why not 12%? Why not 8%?
The 17% was derived from best practices from the Government Financial Officers Association and from Moody's. I will tell you that 17% for a municipality our size is not enough, but as a upper and minimum, it's 2 months of expenditures, which is 17%. So 8%, 12% is not nearly enough to address any downturns that a municipality this size could experience. You can chew up your fund balance fairly quickly. And that's how we came up with the 2 months.
So what I'm hearing is it's your advice that we maintain the 17%, and that's consistent with best practices of government finance officers, and that would be considered by bond rating agencies. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
That's exactly.
Okay. Thank you. Is now the right time to make some comments or just ask questions?
Why don't we start with questions, finish up with that, and then go to comments. Mr. Baruch?
I just want to follow up on that line of inquiry that Vice Mayor Snyder had as well. Mr. O'Connor, theoretically assuming, let's get the hard numbers now. What is currently the difference between 17% and 12% on fund balance? What's the delta in dollars?
Anybody got a calculator available?
Roughly.
I would say about $3 million.
$3 million. Okay. But let's just theoretically say that the council chose to utilize the $3 million right now towards operating. What would happen next year to the tax rate?
Based on projections, the tax rate would still need to go up.
By more than it would by not utilizing the fund balance?
Yes, because when you utilize the fund balance, you're utilizing one-time money for recurring expenditures.
So fair to say with that proposal that it's not sustainable past a year?
That's fair to say.
Thank you.
Other questions? Mr. Duncan?
If I could continue in this vein, I think what would be most helpful for me when I'm talking to citizens who have questions about the unassigned fund balance, number one, I really wish we could call it something different, because unassigned sounds like we've got no use for it. Just the way we describe it, I think, needs to be the catastrophic recovery fund, the something that conveys that this is basically the doomsday fund. And in line with that, you know, we're not a city that relies on one particular big factory or, I mean, I suppose you could say the federal government, but if the federal government goes out of business, you know, the problems of the city of Falls Church will be quite small. I think what I hear people wanting to understand is, what is this amount of money protecting us from? And I know there are examples in our past related to the water litigation and perhaps other examples that you could give, but I'm a little hard put to come up with specifics when people ask me in what circumstance would we deploy any of this money that would justify why we're setting it aside. So I'm not asking for a specific answer tonight, something that I would like for the Budget and Finance Committee to talk about, but think about how we would answer that question, I guess, unless you have something right off the top of your head you can, you know, if BJ's blew up, I mean, I shouldn't say that, but if some particular prominent revenue generator ceased to function for some period of extended months, much impact would that have?
If you had an economic downturn where any of your key indicators flattened out, that would trigger using fund balance to make up for that shortfall. We have budgeted a certain amount for our local taxes, our key indicators, and if we don't meet those targets, we need a source of funding to replace them if that happened. Short of cutting expenditures in the middle of the year, that's what it would be used for. Right? If you had embarked on certain projects, for instance, in your CIP today, you do have PAYGO money. It is coming out of the capital reserve. But should you need money for your other operations, and you said we're not touching the money that's set aside for CIP, then your choices are pretty limited. You're either going to go into your fund balance or you're going to cut expenses. Now, if you try to cut expenses in mid-year, the impact is double. All right? And that's what that fund balance would be there to help you address.
So you could describe it as a expenditure stabilization or taxpayer stabilization, revenue stabilization mechanism as one way of describing what it does, rather than just to say it's an unassigned fund balance. I want an active phrase to describe what it is, rather than it just sits around doing nothing.
In your financial policies, there are clear definitions of what those terms are and what they're used for. I mean, there are accounting terms. It's not like we can turn around and change our financial statements to say, unreserved for rent or tax stabilization.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Okay. Well, let's
terms are the terms that need to be used.
We don't have to make it up here tonight while we're sitting and standing here, but it's just something I would like us to think about so we can describe it better. The second question is, the council policy, as I understand it, does speak to a range of 12% to 17%. I didn't make up that policy. I wasn't here when it was agreed upon. That's what the document says. And I think it's understandable for people to ask, why do we have a range if, in fact, 17% is the floor below which we may not drop, a bit? That question usually comes in the context of, to the degree that this is described as a rainy day fund, certain taxpayers, are saying, it's raining on me now. It's really raining quite hard. And they view this 12 to 17% range as something that the council should have the discretion, has given itself the discretion to deploy in times of duress, understanding, of course, that the ideal is to get it up and keep it up to the highest point of that range as is possible. Why do we have the 12 number at all if what we really are being told is that it's got to be 17?
Right. The 12 was designed as your alarm. Let us assume that you did have some catastrophic event where you had to spend more money than was budgeted and you did not have the revenue to support it. That would be an instance where you would say we'll utilize fund balance to address it. What the policy is there for is to say, yes, you can go below the 17% in that circumstance, but you don't want to drop below 12, because at 12, you then have to start implementing measures to restore your fund balance. All right, so the 12 is there for council discretion, of course, but I don't call individual taxpayer distress a reason to dip into the fund balance. I call losing millions of dollars in your key indicator revenues or having catastrophic expenses instances where you would go into fund balance, because it affects the community as a whole.
So the 12 to 17% number really would come into play only when the council had agreed that, some event occurrence warranted spending from the 17. And when that clock started, then once you got down to 12, then it's, holy cow, we got to turn the lights out and send everybody home. I mean,
that's right.
That's how you would describe it, I suppose.
Yes.
Okay.
That is That means that some event happened that you did not plan for. To consciously plan to use your fund balance because of tax rate pressures does not fall under the category of unexpected event.
It's just business as usual, all right? Okay, that's a good start on that conversation. Thank you.
Vice Mayor Snyder.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to just pursue this just a minute. As I understand it, we're maintaining the 17%. In part, it's what you were saying, but in part, it's also to maintain a reserve so that this city can continue to provide vital services if the unthinkable happens. And frankly, in this region, the unthinkable happens a fair amount. Terrorist attacks happen. Financial crises happen. Natural catastrophes happen. And in the absence of an adequate fund, the city would no longer be able to function, which means you can't pay your police officers and your firefighters, and you can't pay your teachers. So the way I view this is, and I've over time begun to understand this, that this is, in this region, considering the recent history of this region, just in the past 10 years, that a fund balance, particularly for a small jurisdiction that doesn't have a lot of options, is essential if we're going to keep providing the services that this city was created to provide for our citizens in the worst case. So that's the way I understand this fund to function. And that's why maintaining it at the 17% that our financial advisors indicate is important to me. Now, that doesn't mean, as we're going to get to the tax rate and whatever else, that we're not going to reduce the tax rate from the proposal. But this one piece of it strikes me, in the environment in which we exist, as essential if we're going to maintain this government in the case of serious natural or man-made challenges. Thanks.
The questions, as long as we're on this line, oh, I'm sorry, Mary Beth Conley, Ms. Conley.
My question is this. If our unassigned fund balance is at 12 to 17%, are there other funds within the budget, the contingency reserve fund or the open space fund or other funds that add up to more, obviously will add up to more than 17%? And are those funds available in time of emergency?
Generally not.
Why not?
Well, if you have money in your sewer fund, you can't appropriate it for general fund purposes. Okay? Generally, your other funds don't exceed, at least not in Falls Church anyway, because we don't have any other reserves in the general fund.
That's the only reserve.
That's really the capital reserve that is discussed in the policy. When we've attempted to fund it, we've also spent it as we funded it. So you don't have any other reserves. And to say that if you are unable to maintain your fund balance and you need more funding, you can't dip into the sewer fund or the stormwater fund to do that.
Got a question based on what I believe was an earlier statement of yours. Did you say that you thought the 17% was inadequate?
Yes.
And what do you think the number should be?
Probably closer to 25.
25%. So you think the city should have a reserve of 25%?
Yes.
And maybe you can elaborate on that, because I think
Because you're small and because your key revenues are subject to a lot of volatility, you need to be able to have extra reserves to react to those things. It also helps you in terms of your ability to borrow money. You are about to begin looking at borrowing huge amounts of money, and 17% on a borrowing in the $30-40 million range is probably not quite as adequate as it needs to be. So if you had a reserve of 25%, you'd be in a better position. Yes, you'd have a better. I couldn't tell you that, but there are differences between a AAA rated borrowing and a AA rated borrowing, and it's based on your ability to finance and repay your debt. And if you are in such a position where you are stretched out in terms of what your fund balance is there for, it means that you need a higher percentage in that fund balance.
Although that has to be weighed against having another, what would that be, $6 million basically sitting around at the present time earning almost no interest, right, as a fund balance, because you essentially return right now on the general fund is, do you know what that is, that number is now? Do you know what the number is, the rate of return we get on the general fund balance at the present time?
Yes, less than 1%.
How much less, just out of curiosity? Do you know, is it a tenth of a percent?
It's a tenth. A tenth of a percent. A little more than a tenth, yes.
Excuse me?
A little more than a tenth of a percent.
Okay.
May I follow up on, just to be very clear, though, about what we just heard. We are all here bound to the council policy. We are, and I've heard nobody suggest that we should change it. The range is 12 to 17. 17 is the number we're trying to hit. And when we hit that, then the deployment of any monies beyond that will not be described as residing in the catastrophic response fund, which is what, from this moment forward, I'm going to start calling the unassigned fund balance. Because Mr. Snyder had a good way of thinking about it, you know, a way that we can identify with here, you know, terrorist events, natural disasters. I mean, it's a catastrophic response or recovery fund. And that number may not, according to council policy, ever exceed 17%, you know, except for bookkeeping issues, money in and out. But once we hit 17, then we have a discussion about how we deploy any additional net cash positive money. And you will argue, and perhaps we will agree, that some of it goes to capital operating expenses, which, as you said, we create it and then we spend it. And some of it perhaps goes to long-term debt service on capital construction. Am I right about what I just said?
No, that's not what your policy says. Your policy says after you exceed 17% that any excess should go into the capital reserve.
And when you say capital reserve, you mean capital operating reserve. Is that what you mean, or do you mean?
I mean capital reserve.
You mean money that would be used to absorb the cost of, say, debt service on a school or a city hall or a library or whatever.
Yes.
Okay, fine. So that's specifically where that money would go,
yes.
Over 17%.
And there was a floor for that capital reserve also.
And that number is?
$3.75 million.
Is that a percentage or is that just a flat number?
That was a flat number.
So 3.75 million is the number 3.375 is the number that we are obliged to try to hit according to our policy. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Z.
Thank you, Mayor. I have a lot to say about the budget, but I am going to reserve my comments on the budget for the appropriate time. I do have some questions, and the questions are for the architect of the recommendations for the last 3 years that, as I recall, every time you said we need to raise the taxes, and in fact we did, that the revenues generated exceeded expectations, beginning with a fairly low amount of $600,000, and then increasing over the last couple of years. Is that true?
That's correct.
That's great. So are you aware that we have many people living in the city that are either federal employees or contractors that work for the federal government? Do you know what that percentage is?
No.
Would you, well, if you had to characterize it, would you say it would be a lot of people or a small percentage?
I couldn't tell you.
Don't know. Then I would assume that you don't know when the last time the federal employees received a raise, do you?
I've heard it from council members.
And what year would that be?
I believe they hadn't received a raise in 4 years, if not
correct.
Longer.
No raise in 4 years. So let me ask you that on page 93 of the budget proposed, it shows that your office is asking for an increase in aggregate of 3.84%, where the change is approximately 3.64 for salaries and 6.59 for benefits. Could one assume that you guys are all getting a raise?
Yes.
Thank you. No more questions.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay. Why don't we go ahead? I'm going to open this to public comment on all of the matters and then close it to public comment, and then council members can make comments as they would like, and then we'll take a motion for each of the different items. Okay, so why don't I go ahead and open this? Any of the items you've just heard about are open to the public. Anyone who would like to make a comment on any of those items is welcome to do so at this time. Okay, seeing none, then the matter is closed to the public. Why don't we go ahead and now open it up to council member comments? Is there any council members who would like to speak to any of the items we've just heard? I've got that look. Who'd like to go first? Mr. Z.
Take that hand off that button. Okay. So thank you, Mayor. At the outset, let me just repeat myself. I don't think it can be said too often that I support great schools, fair taxes, and a well-designed city. For those that say to me that, you know, I really like some quirky, interesting retail, a couple buildings no more than a story or two high. And you know, my kids finished school here, all four of them went through the school. Thank you for paying for them. But I don't really care about funding the schools anymore. And lastly, don't raise my taxes. I just don't really have a good answer for that. But I do have an answer for my position on grade schools. There are many, many good reasons, but I support the school board's request. I support the school board's request. The school board needs to finish its work. They have 2 more months to do so. At the end of all that, I will support the school board's request. On the fund balance, we have a lot of money in there, and it loses 1.5% each year that it sits in there unspent. Is 17 too much? There are many that say it is. Is it 17 too low? I heard one that said it's way too low. However, I think that the way to thread this narrow path to getting a budget that we can approve is to avoid spending for things that have low priority, lack support, address obsolete needs. In other words, we should spend money on substance, not specious projects. And the other side is we should raise the revenue. We've asked the city to, as they work through the budget, to bring in more refined tax revenues estimates, and then to look at making the development office as either a revenue neutral profit center. I haven't seen that yet, but I'm sure that'll come soon. If not, I will continue to ask. Also, at the outset, I would like to just direct all of our attention to a place like Alexandria. Their salaries and benefits will increase 0.5%, but they're going to hold the line on the tax rate. The Arlington budget for 2015 includes money for employee raises, affordable housing, but the property tax rate is unchanged. The schools are slated to get 4.7% increase. At the same time, the water and sewer rate will rise, the local bus fares will rise, and solid waste collection will rise. I'm pleased to see that our city is doing the same thing with regard to sewer and other places where they can increase taxes besides the real estate tax rate. And finally, Fairfax. To fully fund the school's budget increase, would budget request would require a 0.03 cent on the dollar, or roughly 2%. So they're still arguing over that. And for those that say that, well, you know, we're the city of Falls Church, we're not the city of Manassas or other places. The city of Manassas has a breathtaking 1.395 tax rate because in 2013, they spent over $100 million to improve their downtown, built a new elementary school, and created drainage improvements. 7.1% increase. That's why they're able to say no more. So, there's more to be said over the next 2 months, and you can believe me. I say I'll have plenty more to say about this, but for now, I need to hew to the promise that I made last November. I cannot support a budget rate increase. I mean, a tax rate increase. Thank you.
Thank you. Other comments? Mr. Duncan?
I don't know if you want to go just down the line. I just wanted to say that your budget and finance chair here would just like to say something once everybody has finished their views about the process that we're going to go through, just to make sure that I'm understanding what you and the other senior members want us to do, and to talk a little bit about our budget finance meeting tomorrow night so that the public knows how we're going to begin our work. So I just wanted to put a marker in and reserve a minute or two to talk about that at the end.
Okay, other comments at this point? Mr. Baruch?
Yeah, well, just on the budget matters that are before us, just wanted to say publicly that I'm looking forward to the public conversation that we'll have about the budget as we move forward. I know that we've received lots of comments, almost more than I recall in the past, on the budget this early. So it's very, very, very helpful to get that feedback in the process, and the sooner that we get that feedback, I think the more helpful it's going to be. As I'm looking at this, things certainly are infrastructure, schools, are some of the key aspects I'm going to be looking at. Mr. Z raised the issue of salary increases. I think that's a very, very difficult issue, but I do have to say, you know, we do have a lot of federal employees in the city, and also in the private sector, and I know that the schools are proposing catch-up salaries to catch up with Arlington as far as salaries go, and the city's trying to do what it can on the city side. I think that's an area that the council may want to discuss further, and I know that we don't have line item authority over the school budget, but I think that's an area of conversation that we need to have overall on both sides. And on the school budget, I understand that we're targeting certain things towards Arlington, for example, salaries, et cetera. But as I sit here on the council side, I'd be remiss not to look at Arlington's tax rate and how they come about it. I think we're missing half the equation if we just say we want to peg Arlington salaries or services, et cetera, but don't look at their tax rate and the economic engine that they are at times. So I think we just need to look at those metrics a little bit more carefully. As far as the tax rate goes, I think a lot more discussion needs to happen there. I'm not at the point of saying I'm absolutely opposed to any rate increase. I think we need to work through the budget, see where we're at. I'm not wedded to saying what the manager is proposing is where I'm going to land ultimately, or I'm at a position where I'm going to say no rate increase. What I will say is I'm not going to do or favor any gimmicks or do things that are unsustainable in the long-term interest of the city. I'm not interested in getting through a one-year budget and leaving it for next year. Mm-hmm. So I'd be very interested in getting the five-year projections that we all do every year And I think bringing the tax year in aligned with the calendar year will help really hone in our projections as we move forward. So I think seeing how this all plays out over a five-year period or a three-year period or even a two-year period will be helpful. But looking at it in one budget cycle, saying, you know, we're going to utilize fund balance and not look at where we're going to be next year and the year after that with the type of capital projects that we have, with increasing student enrollment, more pressures on schools, it's just is not a recipe for success to say we're going to focus one year, we're going to utilize our fund balance or whatever it may be to close that gap for this year and we'll deal with next year. That's the strategy that I'm not willing to subscribe to. And I'm not saying anybody on council is saying that right now, but that's sort of my one line. And again, open to hearing about what the priorities are and having further discussions and looking forward to getting public input as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Baruch. Ms. Connolly?
There are certainly a lot of issues related to the budget. I would really like to commend the Treasurer's Office and the Human Services Office for their work on the senior tax relief and deferral. I think that is a really important key piece of this budget, and I am pleased to support that, and I do think that is something that will help a lot of our citizens who have been struggling with taxes, so I think that is really good. I would also really like to encourage city staff to do everything they can to make sure that everyone who is eligible for that knows about it and is able to take advantage of it. And I thought Mr. Duncan's suggestion in the work session last week that we extend the same parameters to give relief to the stormwater fee for those same households would also be a good one to pursue.
Thank you, Ms. Connolly. Other comments? Okay, Ms. Oliver?
I just want to ditto what Ms. Connolly said about the work that's been done on the tax relief. And I just want to also add my thoughts that in my evaluation of nonprofit organizations and businesses that I do on a day-to-day basis, we consider the standard for that catastrophic recovery fund to be 3 months, which is 25%. So I just want to echo that I support, you know, what Richard has said about how, you know, 17% is the minimum really that we can use. I know that we've heard a lot of pain from taxpayers. We've gotten a lot of email. There's a lot of people that are very concerned about this, and I think, you know, we're all aware that this is going to hit some people very hard and in very difficult ways. But I'm also aware that as we have been reviewing different parts of this budget, the most common thing that has come up is, wow, we have this huge unfunded need that you haven't even included. And sometimes it feels like it's something very important, like having more money for traffic calming so that we don't have to worry about kids on bicycles getting hit by cars. So this will be a difficult process. I'm looking forward to the work on it, but I don't think that there are any simple answers, and I'm not optimistic that we can reduce the tax hit a great deal.
Thank you, Ms. Oliver. Mr. Snyder?
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. In all the 19 or so years I've been on City Council, there's never been an easy budget year, so this is no different. It is different, though, because people are, I think, more concerned about the tax rate earlier than I've seen before. So we need to pay attention, and we will pay attention to that. With regard to a couple of the themes we've heard so far, first, on the stormwater fee, this has been talked about for at least a year and a half. And the reason why the decision was made to go with a fee and not a tax was the notion, and this largely came from the environmental community, that those who contribute to the problem should pay for it, and those who do some things to reduce what they do should get a credit. And then because others are contributing to the problem that don't normally pay taxes, that the fee was put in place in order to address that concern, that fundamentally it's an issue created by what we do, and you want to incentivize people to the extent that you possibly can with a fee. So that's why it was done. It wasn't, we all know that people are going to pay more. There was no gimmick here. This was a very difficult policy decision. Frankly, I would prefer if it were deductible. The City Council made the decision to structure this the way that they did, weighing and balancing these in full and open public discussion. And it may well be in the future we're going to have to change some things. There may be ways to fund some of the projects in here in a different way. So I'll be looking for that. But we're trying to confront the need that our citizens have to deal with the current flooding, as well as unfunded mandates from the federal government regarding the Chesapeake Bay, agreed to by the state and then passed on to the localities to fund after the state agrees to these things. So we've seen that happen in the past, and it's happening again here. So we'll keep looking at this and changing it as appropriate. But the reason why it sits the way it did were the reasons that I've indicated. And it was all done in public with a lot of debate and a lot of public input. Second issue was fund balance. We've already talked a lot about that. Third issue is how to use sort of one-time money. And here's where I think there will be some opportunity, from my standpoint, to bring the tax rate lower than has been proposed. To manage to use one-time funds that we have from various sources against one-time capital projects. And I will be personally looking at this budget to see where we can responsibly use one-time money to pay for one-time matters that are otherwise covered in the operating budget. And I think there'll be some opportunities to bring the tax rate down from what's being proposed at this point. And I'll be really focused on that. Of course, we have to ask tough questions of our city manager and of our schools. So the question is, why are these other jurisdictions at a so much lower tax rate? It's a question which I ask myself a lot. Let me give you a couple data points. And I think the schools have been very good on this point. We have a higher percentage, by far, increase in our school population than any other jurisdiction in Northern Virginia. Secondly, we have a much larger percentage of our population that's in the schools than any other jurisdiction in Northern Virginia. Third, we get the least from the state of any other jurisdiction in Northern Virginia. So just within the school part of the budget, which is 50% of our budget, you begin to understand why the costs are the way they are. With regard to the city side, the same thing. We got a little bit in it before. The state took away the right for cities to annex and said, oh, we're going to provide you a high level of public safety funding, which never materialized. Another point is that some of these other larger jurisdictions are frankly getting hidden subsidies from the federal government. The Dulles Corridor is basically the result of federal contracting policies that allowed a lot of activity that wouldn't otherwise be there. We don't have a Dulles Corridor, whether we like it or not. We don't have that. Another point, Arlington County had Crystal City to really get things started. Again, largely funded indirectly through federal tax dollars. We don't have a Crystal City. Likewise, Arlington planned a lot of its zoning based upon the metro. For whatever reason, people who were around there at the time decided we weren't going to have a metro station in our city. So it's good questions, and we'll keep asking them. But there are answers to a lot of these questions. We'll keep collectively working on this budget. I'm convinced we'll get the tax rate down below what it'll be. We hear what people are saying. I have asked for both of our managers, our superintendent and our city manager, to tell me, let's pick a tax rate. Let's pick 130, everything else being equal. What level of services can we get for that? What are our police responses going to be? Or let's really cut it down to like 121. How many police officers would we maintain at that point? What are our parks going to look like at that point? What are our schools going to be able to function at that rate? And that's important for people to say, just cut it. Well, just cutting it, in my view, doesn't cut it, because what will happen is you'll get exactly the services that you paid for. But that said, I do think there are opportunities to get a lower tax rate. I know we'll all be collectively working on that, and we'll probably get there. And my hope is that we will, because we are listening to what people have to say. But ultimately, there's one thing worse than a high tax rate, and that's a school that doesn't teach, police that don't respond, and fire trucks that break down. And it's our job to prevent that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Snyder. Other comments? No? Go ahead then, sure.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My comments, as I said earlier, are going to be mostly about process. I'm looking forward to, maybe this is a glutton for punishment, but I think it's going to be a good opportunity to have a good, deep conversation with the community over all these things that we're wrestling with. And the people up here are all very able and have broad experience in the community, and I think it's going to be healthy to ask some of these questions and try to get answers so that we can take those answers out into the community. I'm looking forward to working with the school board and the superintendent. To that end, as I understand it, the Budget and Finance Committee, or as I experienced it last time, the Budget and Finance Committee is going to operate this time a little differently. The members of the Budget and Finance Committee are Mr. Brugge, Ms. Oliver, Ms. Conley, and myself. There are four of us. We, of course, do not speak in any way for the full council, but the mayor has asked that we take some responsibility, I guess, for meeting and diving a little deeper into some of these issues than perhaps we can do up here on the dais when we have much other business to prosecute. So that's what we're going to try to do starting out. First meeting is tomorrow night, 7:30 at the Oak Room. It's been publicly noticed. All are invited. The topics that I have sketched out for consideration are first, as mentioned earlier, the item on the budget amendment that we talked about in our last meeting, just so Mr. O'Condre can brief us on that. Second, the bigger picture discussion. I mean, I'm very interested to hear these kind of remarks are being made here tonight, and would hope that tomorrow night we could have an opportunity to further talk about, you know, obviously we're not at this just for this year. We need, you know, to look at it 2 years, 3 years. The essential dynamics of the budget are hopefully not going to change. Hopefully there won't be a catastrophe of any kind. You know, school growth will continue. Hopefully revenue growth will continue, but it will not keep up with school growth. So whatever we, you know, have been doing and are going to do this year, we're going to have to keep doing it in the coming years. And so we want to make sure that we do have a longer-term view in mind. So that's the second area that I hope we can cover and hear from each of the members of the committee about where they would hope we could go over a 2 to 3 to 5 year time. And then thirdly, some of these specific items that we're not going to talk much about tonight, I would ask the manager to make sure that we have notes that remind us when someone said, gee, we need to talk about that further, to guide us with those notes. For my own self, I've always felt that the CIP sort of gets short shrift during the budget because, you know, there's so much going on. And, you know, we're spending some real money, and this year we're talking about really spending some real money. And I really would like our Budget Finance Committee to just make sure that we're all understanding what is being proposed, that we can defend it, explain it, and, you know, hopefully come to a consensus on supporting it. I'm specifically thinking of the library project, which I talked about in work session the other night, the City Hall project, and, you know, the assuming the Thackeray School gets done and the TJ work gets done, I'm already checking those boxes off, but the Mount Daniel process, whatever monies are being allocated that are actually going to be spent in the coming fiscal year, let's make sure that we're on board with those and that we're satisfied that that they do represent where we really want to go. So those are a couple of things that I hope we could talk about specifically. Maybe the stormwater fees might be an item. I know it's not, I guess, technically part of the budget, and yet everyone in the public sees it all as a piece. I mean, the things that we're all hearing, of course, are the assessments are up, the proposed tax rate is up, stormwater fees have been added on. I think we need to have some kind of discussion about whether we can provide some kind of relief or at least process for the credits to be more available. So those are three things that I hope we can talk about specifically. Now, we are not scheduled to meet every Thursday night or anything like that, but We could if the members so choose. I see them nodding their heads vigorously that they definitely want to do that. I don't actually, but I'm your servant. I'm planning hopefully to go nowhere for the next month, so tomorrow night we should talk about the schedule.
I think that's a good idea. Why don't we go ahead and have a motion on the first item here? Can we do that?
So on the Budget and Finance Committee, I think before we get too far, maybe we can come back to it at the end, is talk about sort of process, just so we get some direction and understand where all council members are and where they want to go before the Budget and Finance Committee goes off on some random mission, especially since we're four. I'd hate not to get input from the other three on such important issues before we go blazing off.
Yeah, as I said, we, of course, would not do that. My hope, if I could, Mr. Mayor, extend my remarks. As a freshman member last time around doing the budget, I remember then Mayor Brugge kept trying to tease out of us, you know, what do you guys really want to do? And nobody would say. I didn't say what I thought the tax rate should be because I didn't think, really, frankly, it was my place. I was waiting for some guidance from the Budget and Finance Committee. It did not forthcome until the night that we cast the final vote. I personally would hope that we could agree on some number of options, perhaps, in some time frame that would enable staff to work the numbers and, you know, present information to us that we could really discuss in some detail. But that's just me personally. You know, if we get to the end of our meetings and have come to no resolution thereon, then we'll do it the last night, I guess. But it's my personal hope that the process of talking will yield some sort of meeting of the minds, at least on a couple of options that we might present for the full council to consider.
Thank you. Mr. Snyder, Vice Mayor Snyder.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Just because we're going to be voting on a lot of issues here in a minute, many of these I may be voting to get the process started, but it doesn't mean I'm happy where we are. I think that's true of all the council members. We're going to be working really hard through the committee and generally to make sure we're providing adequate, sufficient services and schools, but at the same time, we're going to be looking at where we can cut the tax rate and otherwise, to the extent we possibly can, manage and reduce the burden on our taxpayers. I think that's all that we're going to be working on. So people need to understand that we're voting on these things tonight to get the process started, but we're going to be intensively looking at what we can do over the course of this budget process.
That's a good point. This is absolutely not final action. Tonight is really just setting forth the motion, the wheels in motion, over the coming weeks for further discussion, public hearings, public input. It's a lot of work to be done. It's going to be a difficult year, I think, is all that tax years seem to be. You know, we're getting started here. So with that, why don't we go ahead and have a motion on the first item, if we might.
Mr. Mayor, can I ask, do I need to read the entire wording of TO 14-19, et cetera, or? And someone will help me find it. So,
it sounds like a yes.
Just
to
the
me.
Just the two line version. Okay, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I
yes,
move
please.
To adopt TO 14-19 on first reading, schedule public hearings on April 14th and April 28th, 2014, and advertise the same according to law.
We have a second.
Second.
Okay, Madam Clerk, will you call a roll call vote, please? Excuse me, Mr. Snyder on the second, Vice Mayor Snyder on the second. Yes. I think we need to do them all.
Yeah, right. We're going to do each one of them. Are we going to vote separately on them?
I think we need
to.
Yeah,
we have to.
Okay, fine.
Okay. Mr. Brugge?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
No.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes. Okay, let's move to the second item. Do we have a motion?
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt TO 14-20 on first reading, schedule public hearings April 14th and April 28th, 2014. Second reading and adoption on April 28th, 2014. Advertise the same according to law and refer to item.
For this item,
and refer this item to the Planning Commission, School Board, Library Board, thank you, Library Board of Trustees, Recreation and Parks Advisory Board, Environmental Services Council, and the Arlington County Fire Department.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Vice Mayor Snyder on the second. Could you call the roll call vote, Madam Clerk?
Mr. Brew?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
No.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, let's move to the third item.
Mr. Mayor, I move to approve TO 14-05 on first reading, schedule second reading for April 14th, 2014, and advertise the same according to law.
Second.
Ms. Vice Mayor Snyder on the second. Could you call the roll call vote, please?
Mr. Brew?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
No.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes. Again, let's move to the next item, please. We have a motion.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt TO 14-17 on first reading, schedule public hearings on April 14th and April 28th, and second reading and adoption on April 28th, 2014, and advertise the same according to law.
Second.
Vice Mayor Snyder on the second. Could you please call the roll call vote?
Mr. Brew?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Z?
No.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you.
Next item, please.
Mr. Mayor, I move to adopt TO 14-21 on first reading, schedule public hearings on April 14th and April 28th, and second reading and adoption on April 28th, 2014, and advertise the same according to law.
We have a second?
Second.
Vice Mayor Snyder on the second.
Mr. Brew?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
No.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes. And next item, please.
And finally, I believe, Mr. Mayor, move to adopt TO 14-22 on first reading, schedule public hearings on April 14th and April 28th, 2014, and advertise the same according to law.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Vice Mayor Snyder on the second.
Mr. Brew?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
No.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you, Council.
Could you call the next?
I'm done, right?
Yes, I think so.
I think we're done.
Can you call the next item, Madam Clerk?
TR 14-12 is a resolution to amend the agreement for the sale of the post office lot.
Thank you. Mr. Shields?
Before we do that, I have two questions. One on this item that I need to make a prudential disclosure, but I had one question on the CIP since we were moving at lightning speed.
Sure.
Before I had asked for some clarifications, et cetera, on how it's laid out, that included whether the numbers that are PAYGO versus bonded out or that are going to be bonded out in the out years are different or whether we need to make some adjustments. We don't need to answer it tonight, but I just want to make sure we don't, with whatever we do, don't have to come back to a first reading if the money stays the same, but the amount of PAYGO versus bonding is different. Mm-hmm. So that's a question for the city attorney. So hopefully the answer is we don't need to come back if we need to make adjustments between what's being bonded and what's being done in PAYGO if the figure is the same. So let's just not have any last-minute surprises with a needing to come back. And if we need to come back for some reason to make that change, let's do it sooner rather than later. So
yeah, the goal would be to make that change by April 14th so that you could adopt everything on April 28th.
Or if we need to do it in a first reading again, if we need
14th.
To make change. Yeah, let's just do that so we're not screwing up the timing is my point. And then as related to the item that we're about to take up, TR 14-12 on the post office lot, as I've previously disclosed as a prudential matter, I own property at 243 Gundry, and I'm part of the HOA, and my wife is president of that HOA. And after extensive discussions with the past city attorney and the current acting city attorney, as a prudential matter, I'm making the disclosure and have filed with the city clerk as well. I can consider these matters fairly objectively and in the public interest.
Thank you, Mr. Brew. Mr. Shields? Yes, absolutely, Ms. Oliver.
Yes, I'd also like to disclose that I'm a member of the Winter Hill Community Association. I own a home at 157 West Annandale Road, and this discussion pertains to property that is near to but not immediately adjacent to my home. However, I am a member of a group of three or more individuals affected by this transaction. I certify that I can participate in this discussion fairly objectively and in the public interest.
Yes. And since we're using the certified language apparently now with this new city attorney, I'll change my language to certify, if that's helpful to the city attorney, just to keep it consistent with everybody else.
Okay, great. Thank you. Mr. Shields?
Thank you, Mayor Tarter, members of council. Council is asked to authorize by resolution for the city manager to execute an amendment to the agreement for sale of the post office lot. The EDA earlier this evening met at 6 p.m. and authorized its chairman, Mike Novotny, to execute the same amendment to the agreement. Patrick Carney, representing the Falls Church Development Partners, is here in the room if the council has any questions. But just very briefly, what the amendment will do, the council has already acted to authorize the sale of this land. I did so back in October of 2012 for a fair market price of $4,322,000 for both lots, the EDA lot and the city lot. That agreement required that the development partners obtain land use approvals for the site and obtain a lease for a grocery store for the site. Those conditions have been met. The development partners have requested a change to the agreement to strike the provisions relating to the city and the EDA's ability to buy back the property should the project not proceed to construction or not be completed in accordance with the established deadline. That provision was unacceptable to the lenders for the project, and so the request is to strike that provision. This agreement would strike that buyback clause. It would add two substantive provisions to the agreement, along with some other more minor changes. But the substantive changes would be to have the closing on the sale of the land simultaneous with the closing on the development partners obtaining a construction loan for the full project. So that's the first key provision. And then the second is the developer has offered additional consideration to the city in the amount of $100,000 for accepting this change to the agreement. I do want to thank Mr. Carney for his work with us as we've gone through this change. He's been very transparent in terms of some key things that the city wanted to check to make sure that we get what we intended at the end of the day, which is the project that the council has approved through the SE application, and very importantly, the grocery store, which is so important for our downtown, for the economic vitality of the entire city, and for the fiscal impact of this particular project. So that's the summary of the requested change. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Mr. Rick Goff is also in the audience, and he's been working very hard with Mr. Carney, along with Mr. Taves, to bring this to this point. And the council's also worked very hard on this as well.
Thank you. Questions, Mr. Baruch?
A couple questions. One that may be best addressed by Mr. Carney, and then some of them for staff as well. If you can let us know a little bit about this provision of the buyback has been in the agreement for over a year now, and I know that things change. And I know that we've internally discussed this in some of our closed sessions, but I think it's important for the public to understand why you're requesting the change and what happened with the financing, specifically given that this provision had been worked on through boards and commission processes, and why we're here today requesting this change, because it is a significant change, and I think it's important for the public to understand from your standpoint why your lenders are telling you what they're telling you.
It was my mistake. I should never agree to that clause in the contract in the beginning. That's kind of the first thing. But it didn't really come to light until we were going into the closing on the property. And there was going to be a note to the deed that this buyback clause was a string attached to the deal going forward, which raised through the construction loan process. So it was something that I had not really paid a whole lot of attention to. It was really my fault on why that was in the contract. In the real world, that wouldn't be allowed in anybody's contract because there isn't a construction lender out there that would have given a jurisdiction a buyback right, particularly in this case where part, it's not the whole site. The city lots are only part of the site. The other site is on a ground lease. There's complicated foreclosure proceedings that go through, and so it would have to be subordinate to a lender. And then we got into all kinds of different scenarios to try and, quote, water down that language to give the city something that they could hang their hat on that had the same spirit of what was going on there. We really couldn't come up with any. So we kind of hit an impasse about whether this project can go forward at all with that language. So it wasn't something that we did and we're trying to slide by. It really was our fault in that it should have never been in the contract in the first place. It really wasn't a market provision in a contract. It wasn't something we were really focusing on at that time. You gotta remember that was 2.5 years ago and we had a Harris Teeter lease to finalize, the zoning approval to finalize. There were a lot of other hurdles that we were focusing on. So what we did do to try and then get back to the goals of what the city wanted, and that was to make sure that they had a project, was to not buy the city lots until we gave significant evidence that we have a construction loan. We have been waiting to start to do this. We've already pushed back our construction start date by about 3 weeks right now. We have a construction loan that's ready to close. We'll probably close next week as soon as we get this paperwork done. We gave a lot more evidence to the city than was required to the zoning process about how this financial puzzle was put together on this property like any project. So we tried to be as transparent as possible to show that this thing is going forward and with all due cause and with the way that everyone is hoping is going to in the beginning. So the spirit of the clause was the city didn't want to find out that this wasn't going to work and they've given up a economic development piece of the puzzle in terms of real estate in the city. I think they have assurances that the deal is going forward. They have the Harris Teeter lease, they have the financing in place, we're ready to start construction. I think they're in the same spot.
Yeah. No, thank you for that, and thank you for taking responsibility of what happened. But I would also be remiss that if I didn't sort of express, I hope this doesn't happen again. And I know things are always fluid, and given the circumstances and given how important this project is, I'm going to support this, I think, after I ask some further questions. But I think it's important for you and fellow developers to know that these last-minute issues for a contract that's been negotiated and went through extensive public process, now we're at the final hour, and the documents, for obvious reasons, don't go on the website until hours before the meeting. Council members are not getting the staff report until hours before the meeting, if that. Makes it very difficult. That's sort of acceptable in the public realm, or I'm sorry, in the private realm, in business relationships, private businesses to private businesses. It's very problematic from a transparency public standpoint. I understand that we need to move, given where things are at for you and lining things up. But this is not the way we should be conducting ourselves. And I'd just be remiss not to say that publicly, that it does give me some pause that we're having to act on this in the fashion that we're at. So it's very unfortunate that we're having to do this on the time frames that we're needing to act.
I agree, it's unfortunate. We just tried to be as transparent as we could once the issue came up to continue to align everybody's interest to move forward.
And this is not to cast blame, but it's just to say that let's just not repeat this again. And then two, just looking through the staff report, I think you're right, since I think several of us were involved in that negotiating process of the clause, it was to make sure that the project was moving timely. That's why there was essentially two actually clawbacks or buybacks, if you will. One was if ground hadn't broken within a certain period of time, or if the project hadn't been completed within a series of time. I think it was 12 months and then 24 months were the two triggers. Looking through the staff report, it looks like with your lending agreement through your construction loan, you have to complete construction within 26 months.
Yes.
Which gives me a little bit more comfort that this thing is going to happen.
There is a completion guarantee as part of that.
That's what I was going to talk to you about. That's not covered in the staff report.
Yes.
What happens to, let's say you miss your deadlines, what happens on the construction loan side? What are the penalties that they impose on you,
et cetera? Well, we'd be in default under the construction loan at that point. So the lender would have all remedies to try and collect any damages, to include going through a foreclosure under a worst case under that, which is actually a much higher burden for us than probably a buyback clause would have been just for the land.
Are there any penalties that you have to pay based on the number of days that you're delayed, et cetera?
There's not like a punitive damages thing. It just kicks you into a default situation, which no one wants to be in, and it triggers a bunch of things that can cascade if you don't solve that default in a timely manner.
Okay. I am going to be supportive of this this evening. I know that usually our resolutions say, you know, the city manager goes and does this agreement. We're not actually voting on the agreement per se, but authorizing the city manager to do it. One thing that I hope can be thought through further, it sounds like there's some, you know, I'm sort of hoping that the bank got it right on their end with sort of, if you're not done within 26 months, then we're going to do something to you. Sounds like it's a little unclear what that something is, other than foreclosing, et cetera, or pulling the project. But I hope that there can be further discussion, even though the council is likely to act tonight, about whether we can put in some incentives to make sure that the benchmarks are being met. One way that's done in the private sector is if you don't complete a project within X period of time, you pay $25,000 a day, hypothetically speaking. So, you know, I don't think that, you know, I'm not interested in getting involved in those discussions right now, but I hope we can give that some thought, and I think there's enough wiggle room, I hope, in the language to give some ability to the manager just to make sure that you can still do the project, move forward, but there's continued incentives to make sure this project is moving speedily. So that's my hope. And then two, this is a question for staff on the additional monies that's coming in for closing. This relates to back to what I was talking about, CIP, is accountability and showing what's happening with the money. You know, this notion that it's gonna go into the undesignated fund balance and nobody knows where it ends up. I understand why it's happening right now to give us some flexibility, but I also don't want to later find out that I asked what happened to that $100,000 and it's gone into operating. Sorry, we didn't tell you because it's under some threshold or something like that. There just needs to be a way that we can account and trace for all the money that's coming through the land sale, which is now hitting $4.4 million or so. I just think that we need to have transparency through that and make sure if we're designating it for projects, et cetera, that that's clear, because who's going to remember what happened here today or at closing 3 or 4 years down the road? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Baruch. Any other comments? Why don't we go ahead and open this up to the public? Why don't we take a motion, then we'll open it up to the public. Mr. Z?
Mayor, I would like to move adoption of TR-14-12.
Second.
Okay. Why don't we now go ahead and open this to the public? Are there any members of the public that wish to address this matter? Seeing none, the matter is closed to the public. Are any council comments, additional council comments? Mr. Snyder, Vice
just
Mayor
one,
Snyder.
Just one, Mr. Mayor. I'm convinced that if we didn't do this, project would fail.
Thank you very much. Why don't we go ahead now and do a roll call vote?
Mr. Baruch?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yes.
Mr. Z?
Yes.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you, Council.
Thank you very much. So the next item is the consent agenda.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. I would like to, excuse me here. move to reappoint Peter Adrians to the Environmental Services Council, March 2014 to the end of February 2017.
Thank you. Did you make a motion? I'm sorry.
Yes, I move the reappointment.
Okay, I'm sorry. Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
Ms. Connolly? Okay, why don't we call the roll call vote then, Madam Clerk?
Mr. Baruch?
Yes.
Ms. Connolly?
Yes.
Mr. Duncan?
Yes.
Ms. Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Snyder?
Yeah. Yes.
Mr. Z?
Yes.
Mayor Tarter?
Yes.
Thank you, Council.
Is there any business not on the agenda? No. Council member comments? Brief?
Just one. Mr. Carney may have already left, but just wanted to take note of the groundbreaking for the project that we had this morning. Fine comment. Thank you, Mr. Carney, who has not left. Wanted to thank you for the groundbreaking event this morning. Very fine affair. Good comments made by the manager and the people associated with your project and our mayor. Thank you very much. Very exciting event.
Thank you. Ms. Connolly?
I just have three things. Two are related to the issue of split lots and substandard lots. I want to thank you, Mr. Shields, for the information that you provided and to council. And we're going to have a meeting with Mr. Snyder, a briefing from Mr. Snyder on that.
We need to just find a convenient time for you and for anyone else who would like to go. If it's more than two, then we do need to have 3 days advance notice. So if council members could let us know if you would like to come. I think I know we have two that want to come. If there are any additional, maybe let me know as by tomorrow, close the business, and then we'll go and proceed and get that scheduled as
okay.
quickly as possible.
Okay, very good. And then regarding the matter of the property on Van Buren Street, the Hiscott property, what is our schedule for that? Will there be additional comment?
I would propose that we do have some additional correspondence that we've received that we should review, and council has requested some additional information. The council next meets on April 7th, and so discussed this with the mayor and proposed having this as a closed session discussion on April 7th. If the council is in agreement with that, we'll communicate that to the Hiscott so they just understand sort of what that element of the schedule is yet. We don't know yet when, if there's any council action, when that would be scheduled, but at least let them know that step in the process.
Okay. And then my third question just relates to the pilot of the Kensington property. And that is a topic that has come up several times. People are concerned, don't quite understand it. Is that will there be an opportunity? Who is in charge of looking at that and making sure that it meets what we wanted to say?
Mm-hmm. If you could direct your questions to me, Rick Goff has been the staff lead on that, but I can distribute questions and we can get responses to you. And then Pat Taves, of course, has been working the legal angle to it.
Okay, thank you.
And it's no longer called a pilot. We call it the cash payments.
Cash payments, okay.
Mr. Z?
Just two things. Are we going to have an open house on the Kensington? Have you scheduled that?
We will. The Planning Commission is taking the lead on that. And so what is proposed is the Planning Commission will host an open house for all of our boards and commissions. And that also is scheduled for April 7th.
April 7th?
That is correct. The council has a work session that night. But the word is going out to all the boards and commissions for that. And it is intended to bring everybody together at once so there can be sort of the cross-pollination of questions and ideas and input on the project. Then the boards and commissions will be able to go off on their own and provide their formal recommendations.
Will this be facilitated by Cindy Mester or somebody equally skilled?
I don't know who our facilitator is. Cindy, are you up for the job? I think Jim is going to do that. I think the developer will give a presentation. And the Planning Commission is working through the choreography of how to host what will be the sort of the first time we've had this type of open house.
All right, but make sure they check their weapons in at the door, all right?
Yeah.
And the second question goes to the West End Park. Are you prepared to brief meantime?
Again, that's something we need to schedule with the council. We've sent the plans out to the council so you can review them, but it's hard to see them on PDF. It'd be much better to walk through them. So
I'd like to make that more expeditious. I've got some very targeted questions.
Okay. Why don't we come in? We could talk about it one-on-one, and then we can go with the full council briefing at a later date.
Thank you, Mr. Z.
Thank you.
Vice Mayor Snyder, do you have a comment?
Just very quickly, I wanted to thank the Tenor Hill Heritage Foundation. They did another of the heritage tours. It was a pleasure to participate in that, and also thank the League of Women Voters and all the participants, including the mayor and others, in a what I was a very well-attended session on future visioning and the use of the GM property area. Thank you.
Thank you. It was a very nice event and well-organized, and quite a lot of folks attended, so it was a pleasure to be there. Do we have any minutes to approve? I did not recall seeing any. Okay, great. So do we have a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
A second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, motion carries.